One. Can you hear me? Hi. I want to welcome you to this breakout session. We're going to hear from Brent Allen. Brent has been the vice president, or is the vice president of Lifetime. He's been there for 29 years. Before that, he was a teacher at a junior high. He's also been a coach, just an inspiration to all of us to kind of teach the processes and things like that. He's also the proud father of five children and has 13 grandchildren. He also, in his spare time, he likes to hike and play pickleball. So we'd like to welcome Brent Allen.
We'll start with a short video. We're very proud of the products that we make. Lifetime is a private company, grown into one of the largest private companies in Utah, based in Clearfield. We have 1,800 employees now. And as you can tell from the video, we make fun products. I remember when we were just starting, my assignments was sales, and I was in a lobby of a warehouse club. You always wait to meet with the buyer, and they take you back to the buyer's office, and so you spend a lot of lobby time, we call it. And I was all pumped up. We were introducing the adjustable basketball system, which was our premier first product. And before that, you used to have basketball systems that you had to climb up a ladder, and there's a U-bolt, and you had to undo it, and it took you about 20 minutes. And I was an instant adjustment. With a broom handle. And so we were bringing this innovative family fun product to a warehouse club. You can imagine it was one of our first sales calls, and I was just totally pumped. And as you're sitting there waiting for your term, there's all kinds of other salesmen that are in this lobby. And so make up conversation. I talk to the guy, and he says, well, what do you make? And I says, I make adjustable basketball system. It's this innovative products, and everybody will be able to slam dunk like Michael Jordan. And what do you make, sir? And he says, I make clothes hangers. And I says, I'm sure that's a nice product, but it is fun to make fun products, the kayaks, everything. We've grown from in basketball when we started. We were one of five companies, and we had probably 2% of market share, and now we have 70% of market share. That's tough to do. Our major customers are Sam's, Walmart, Costco, Dick's, Lowe's, Home Depot. So glad here to represent Lifetime Products. We'll tell a little bit of our story today. So much of what we've tried to do, 6 years ago we were introduced to the Shingo group here, the Shingo Institute here at Utah State. Much of what I'm going to be sharing with you today is our attempt to adopt their model. Their model basically has four parts: principles, systems, tools, and results. At Lifetime, we pretty well instituted it the way most companies done. Our first thing was on results, measurements. Second thing, we had a lot of tools. We focused a lot of lean and on the lean tools. Then because of the Shingo, we started focusing on principles. And then the last thing that we really have been able to work on is systems, how to put it all together as a system. Results. Operational excellence is achieving the right results with the right behavior. So these are results. These are company-wide results that we share with all of our employees on a monthly basis. This is year-to-date. Sales growth, we had a goal at 3%, and we're up to 11%. And yes, that causes a lot of problems, but they're good problems. We have a profit-sharing program. We share 10% of the profit of the company with the employees. We have a big meeting. We have a state of the company meeting, and then everyone receives the same check at the same amount. They average about $1,000. They've gone up to $2,000. So we feel like that's a big motivating part. Finished goods on hand, that's the first red arrow. We measure that in days on hand. And our goal is 12, and we have 21 days. So that's an area we need to do more work on. Raw material, we're above goal. WIP inventory, we're above goal. Cost of quality is 1.08%. That's a little bit higher than our goal. That may sound like a high number, but we really run three factories at the same time. We run our assembly factory where we assemble our products, but then we also supply 80% of our raw material. So we have a steel mill that produces steel tubing. Then we have blow molding facility. We are the largest blow molder west of the Mississippi. So those three numbers are all included in this 1%. So if you break it out into three factories, that's almost 0.33. Our biggest concern with quality coming back happens to be with one of our largest customers, which is Costco. They have a you can return it for any reason policy. In fact, we went to one of their distribution centers and a return center where all the products come down, and there was a stack of our tables. And the Costco employees called our tables rentals. And the reason for that is the Costco member has a big event and they'll go buy some of our tables and use it for their wedding or something and then take it back on Monday and it all comes back to us. So that's just part of doing business with the major retailers. Then we have ship on times 80%, and we're at 80% now. Safety we measure in hours without incident. And then the last one is Kaizens, which we'll be talking about today. Tools. So this is, as many of you will recognize this, this is based on the Toyota production system, House of Lean. This is our House of Lean. I'm pleased to say that on the foundation, we've been spending a lot of work on visual, standard work, PDCA, Kaizen, strategic plan. We try to take those five throughout the whole company. And the other areas can be more specialized. We've done quite a bit with value stream, Kanban pool, SMED, stop and fix, coaching, and problem solving. Probably the other ones, TPM, Judoka, and error proofing are things we hope to do better in the future. So that's our list of lean tools that we're focusing on. Shingle model. We recognize the necessity of good improvement tools, but focus on them only within the context of enabling a system to better drive ideal principle-based behaviors. So principle. This is a definition of what a principle is. A principle is a fundamental truth, a belief, a rule of conduct, a basis of action. So these are some of the principles. These happen to be Shingle principles that we have adopted at Lifetime. Respect for every individual, lead with humility, focus on processes. This little hand here says a handout. I have a handout with six documents. If you're interested in the handout, they're back on that table. And as you're leaving, you're welcome to take a handout. On this particular handout, I've got about 40 principles that are listed. And we're attempting to implement most of these, more some than others. So when you look at principles, there's lots of principles, and you have to decide which ones you're going to try to implement. Okay. So what is a principle? We've struggled with what is a principle. So we start here. It says, our climate is changing. So that's a belief. But it may not be one of your principles because you might not believe it. You know, somebody else might believe it. You might not believe it. So we go to the next one. Our climate is changing because of air pollution. Again, that might be your principle, but it might not be somebody else's principle. But you get to the last state. Because our climate is changing, we need to reduce air pollution. So we found that a belief does not become a principle until it's a basis of action. So you go back to the definition. So principle is more than a belief. We believe all kinds of things, but we don't do anything about it. A principle has to become a rule of conduct, a basis of action. In other words, this is something we believe, and because we believe it, we're going to do these things, whether it's environmental or safety or anything else. If you're not adopting it, and if you're not using it as a basis of action, it really isn't a principle. It's just somebody's thought. It's just some idea. So making it into a principle is making it into a belief that you're going to do something about. Okay? W. Edwards Deming, one of the fathers of modern thinking, born in Cody, Wyoming. Who was famous for being born in Cody, Wyoming? Wild Bill Cody, named after him. And he was a famous cowboy, I guess you'd say him, and he actually traveled the U.S. and put on Wild West shows. And little W. Edwards Deming actually knew Wild Bill Cody personally as a little boy. So he was born in Cody, Wyoming. After he graduated from college, he spent his first 15 years working in physics. actually worked in a physics lab. Then his next 40 years, he spent in statistics and quality. And only the last 13 years of his life, and yes, when he was 80 to 93, he focused on management. He felt that was the biggest problem. And his biggest problem was what he called the prevailing system of management in the U.S. And the prevailing system of management was basically control. How do you control the equipment? How do you control the people? And he felt that the concept of controlling people was all wrong, and that we had to change the way we managed. So the job of management should be the optimization of a system. That was his major teaching in his last years. Okay? The responsibility for improvement of a stable system rests totally on the management. So you've often heard the phrase, you don't blame the person, you blame the process. And a system is just a group of processes. But why? Why did he believe that so much? And his major belief was that everyone already is doing their best. Isn't that interesting? So if people are always already doing their best, then the problem isn't the people. The problem is the environment, the system they're working in. Okay? Systems are basically high-performance teams. If you look at some of the most famous high-performance teams, we obviously have the team that is changing tires. And how long does it take them to do the pit stop? Anybody? Say that again? Yeah, gas there. 4, 5, 6 seconds. It's amazing. And so they have a system down. They have a process. They practice the process. They don't leave anything to chance. Next one is operating team. They, again, have a system, meaning an organized process, defined roles. Everybody knows what to do and works in concert. Okay, one of the most famous systems is a high-performance team is an aircraft carrier. That they have a very difficult job to do and work together as a team within a system. Any of you that have ever been in the military, they talk about doing it by the book. Well, in the military, there isn't a book. There's literally thousands of technical manuals, operations manuals. There's a manual to do everything. There's a manual to put up a tent. There's nothing in the military that doesn't have a manual that they want you to follow. Do it by the book. Okay, then we have the Toyota production system. You see there's a little Prius being made there. Okay, so this is an example of a lifetime system. This was brought to us by Jacob Raymer from the Institute, from the Shingo Institute. So if you look real carefully, this is a system that is developed not only to execute, but to improve. So when Deming was talking about systems, he was talking about a very specific type of system. He was talking about a system that is designed from the beginning for improvement. And you can apply that improvement system, whatever you're doing or whatever you're making. Okay, so in this case, we've identified these elements. So a system is a collection of parts that are highly integrated to accomplish an overall objective. So we have identified the elements of a system at lifetime is measurements, principles, tools, and then we've broken out some of the specific tools. We put standard work as important enough that we teach that as a separate tool. It's really a tool, but it's an important tool. Then we have training and audits. In fact, to create a learning system, we're seeing at lifetime that it's easy to have results, it's easy to have tools. The thing that we lack an improvement system is the training, and very specifically the auditing, to go back and see, are people doing what they said they were going to do? This is Dave Winter. Dave Winter is one of our vice presidents. He's over 80% of the company now, which includes all of manufacturing and R&D. And he came up with a big realization that we were doing standard work wrong. We read all the books, and the standard work was to document the best way of doing something. What's wrong with that definition? Sounds pretty good to me. Well, how our people were implementing this is they would go out and they would write down the perfect process. Well, how practical is it that they're going to do the perfect process? So we'd have these perfect processes written down in three-ring binders, and guess what happened to those three-ring binders? They got on the shelf and got dusty processes. So he says we're doing standard work backwards. But the way to do standard work is to start with your current. Is a great, but that's not what he said. No, keep going. You got to get this word. Crappy. Crappy. Now, why did he use the word crappy? Because he wanted to make sure that people were understanding, start where you're at, not where you want to be. Start with where you're at. And then you use that to Kaizen against. You start there and you start improving it. In fact, that's one of the handouts, as you see down there. It talks about you start with your crappy process. It doesn't matter what format is in. Write it down. What are you doing now today? Take a piece of paper. Take anything. But then start looking at it and start improving it. In our metals facility, they took this to heart and looked at a process and went over and over and over again. It took them about 10 different revisions until they got a particular process right. And that process was very different than what they had envisioned the perfect process would be. So don't start with what your process you want it to be. Start with where you're at. So start with your crappy process. In fact, I've used this so many times, I call it the DWCP, Dave Winter Crappy Process, and people know what I'm talking about. Okay, so the next thing is training. Now, training comes in many different forms. Coaching, peer training, classroom training, practice exercises. Can't emphasize enough that we've got to figure out a way that people can be trained. Probably the most effective training there is peer training and allowing workers time to develop their own training. With the advancements of digitally now, you can take a video on an iPhone. You can go to a problem. You can go to the something's that's doing well and take a 30-second video and talk about it. That's the kind of training that can be powerful, can be short, can be reoccurrent, needs to be all the time. Then the next one's audits. Performance reviews, process standard work audits, PDCA project reviews, Gemba walks. Again, what does the term Gemba mean? Excuse me? You go watch the process. It's the workplace. So you go to Gemba. Wherever the work is taking place, you go there. One of the things that Toyota used to do with management trainee, somebody that was going to be trained at Toyota, one of the things they used to like to do is they take somebody out into the production floor, and the sensei, the teacher there, would take a piece of chalk and draw a square, a chalk square, on the floor of the factory floor and say, stand there, don't leave that square, and observe this morning. Just observe. And then this afternoon, you tell me what you've observed. That's 4 hours of standing, so we don't necessarily need to do that, but we need to spend more time observing, auditing, giving feedback. Okay, so we want to adapt this idea of a system, of the elements of a system, to Kaizens. Kaizens was one of the first tools that we embraced. We've been working 6 years since we really made a commitment to create an improvement system at Lifetime Products. It's been 6 years. The first tool we really embraced was Kaizen. So we'll talk to you a little bit about the Kaizen system. Okay, so first of all, what is a Kaizen? Kaizen is a small incremental improvement. Our definition that Richard Henriksen, who is our president, taught at our last general meeting was a Kaizen is a small, usually inexpensive process, product, or safety improvement. A Kaizen can be a suggestion. But what does the suggestion imply? It implies that's something for somebody else to do. And those are Kaizens, but our emphasis is on a Kaizen as something that you do, that you do in your area to improve your area. And we're making progress with that. About 80% of our Kaizens now are being done by the people themselves. Small improvements. Okay, results. So our goals, our results in our Kaizen systems, all employees will be able to identify problems and execute effective solutions. Number two, all employees will be able to create tools that drive system improvement. So let's talk about a minute that's the tool. How many of you are implementing Visual Workplace by show of hands? A Visual Workplace, so a visual device, is a small tool. It's a tool to improve. So that would be an example. If you're doing standard work, if you're creating standard work, you're creating a tool to improve a process. If you create any type of a new report, if you're creating anything that can be used to improve, then you've created a tool. So most of the Kaizens are creating some type of a tool or some way of eliminating waste, some way of finding to eliminate waste. So this is our Kaizen measurement. Sorry, it's just up till July. Couple things you'll see is this is our goal line. We had to raise it. It used to be down about here. In fact, we doubled it, didn't we? It used to be down about here, but we hit it. So this is basically a Kaizen per employee per month. So that's how we came up with the goal. And we've been able to hit those goals and produce those Kaizens. Now, the big thing we had to decide is, what is a Kaizen? Kaizen, we looked at some other people's systems, and they had a typo as a Kaizen, because it's a small incremental improvement. We don't count that as a Kaizen. There has to be something substantial that has to be done. It's not just a correction. It's not normal maintenance. It's not handing in a requisition. That's the kinds of Kaizens we do. So principles. The basis of all Kaizens is creative. The purpose of Kaizens is manyfold. One of them is to eliminate waste. The second part, which is even more important, is to allow employees to be creative. Give them an opportunity to be involved in the creative process. So you can tell if you have a Kaizen because if somebody has an idea, they've created an idea. If there's an act of creation, there's a kaizen. If there's no creation, there's really not a kaizen. One purpose of standard work is to provide a baseline to kaizen against. Okay? Some of the other tools. This is a kaizen card. It has two parts to it, so the employee keeps one and supervisor can keep one. Or who if it's out of the area, out of the area can go. So they just fill this out. Let me read it real quick for you. This is one of the handouts. So you just put your name down, your area, what the problem is, what the action, what the proposed solution is. And it has a way of approving that kaizen, the results of the kaizen. So we use this. Now Deming says one of the Deming principles in his 14 points is to drive out fear. Can employees have fear of improvement, of driving improvement? What fear could they possibly have? What fear do employees have? Excuse me? Put yourself out of work. Very good. What else? By show of hands so we can hear you. Go. Okay. Dumb idea, so they're afraid of ridicule. They're afraid of being ridiculed by who? Their peers. They're afraid of being ridiculed someplace else. They are scared to death that they're going to have an idea and somebody's going to say that's a dumb idea. By the way, it might be a dumb idea. So you have to create a culture, then you can have dumb ideas. In one of my previous lives, I was a teacher. And there's a book by Chaim Ganat that's called Between Parent and Child. This book's 40 years old. In this book, Chaim Ganat talks about a little girl, and we'll call her Susie. And Susie is coming from a troubled situation. Her parents were just divorced, and when you get divorced, you generally end up moving. So this is Susie, and this is not only her first day in kindergarten, but it's her first day in the new neighborhood, and she knows nobody. And she's terribly upset that she's been separated from her parents, and it's the first day of school. Now, as a little getting acquainted exercise, the teacher says, I want you to draw something about your family. I want you to draw your house, your backyard, a toy, but something that is about your family. And they passed out the crayons, and everybody was sitting down and drawing. And Mary and Molly drew houses and dollies and doggies and flowers and rainbows and unicorns, and it was all happy. And little Susie took three crayons only, black, brown, and purple. And she took those crayons and took that piece of paper on that piece of paper. The teacher came around and looked at that drawing. Most teachers would be taught to say, Susie, that's an interesting drawing. Susie, that's a creative drawing. Not this teacher who was my hero. This teacher, and this was 40 years ago, put her arm around Susie and said, Susie, that's an ugly picture. You can draw ugly pictures in my class. Can your workers draw ugly pictures? Can they have bad ideas? How do you treat bad ideas in your company? There's a tremendous amount of fear. What Deming was talking about is management has to create a system, an environment where the workers are safe to be creative. I remember when we started our Kaizen program and we had these cards that you, if you have a Kaizen outside of your area at Lifetime, you're able to go to anywhere in the company and say, this is a Kaizen. I think you guys in HR ought to do this better. I think you guys in sales ought to do this better. I had a person in R&D have an idea for something in my area. I've been there 30 years and one of the senior management, and she was fairly new, and she came up to me with this Kaizen. She had a Kaizen and she was shaking, literally shaking with this Kaizen. So I was kind to her and I says, well, what's your Kaizen? Showed her a lot of interest and she had a good idea and we worked on it. The point that this part of the system gave her enough confidence that she felt she could come to a vice president in the company and share an idea. Without the system, she wouldn't have been able to do it. So the point of the system is to be able to create a safe environment where people can create. This is one of our effective tools. Okay, this is a Kaizen board. So, Kaizen board, you can see here, they're able to take out a Kaizen card, and they fill it out, they submit it, then it goes into implementation, then it's finished. And right up here, some standard work and some measurement. And we have a lot of these Kaizen boards. We have over 100 Kaizen boards in the company. So a work cell would have a Kaizen board. In the areas of the company that's working well, and by the way, I have two people from Lifetime here. This is Jared and Jason from Lifetime. I'm pleased to have them. They do Kaizens the best at Lifetime. So I want to give them a hand. If you don't mind, I want to recognize them. Amazing number of Kaizens that they have done. One of the reasons they do it is they do what's called Kaizen of the Week. And they review the Kaizens, and this is in Dave Winter's organization. They review the Kaizens, and the best ones are able to get some votes from an area, and they go from a work cell to an area to a department, and goes all the way up to Dave Winter, which is a division, and identify what is the best Kaizen. We provide some recognition for that. I love the speaker earlier that said that they had a Kaizen event, a Kaizen fair, where everybody came in and recognized Kaizens. So the idea of recognizing Kaizens is very important. This is a digital Kaizen. This came about because the sales guys never want to do it the same way as everybody else. They are special. And so filling out a card was way too much work for them. So we took a card and made it digital. If you notice, it's the same outline, and they just fill it in digital, and they send it to, once it's completed, they send it to a specialist who records a completed Kaizen. There's a couple decisions if you're doing a Kaizen system that you have to decide. And it's different in every company. The first of all, you have to define what a Kaizen is. Second of all, you have to decide how you're going to measure Kaizens. And there's two ways to do it. One is to do it when you initiate a Kaizen. And a good thing about that is you're asking people to produce more Kaizens. We chose not to do that. We chose to count Kaizens only when they're completed. The third choice you have to decide is how you're going to record those Kaizens. Well, we wanted to have a searchable database, which is this sort of slide up here. This is an access database that we've developed over the years. And We're able to search Kaizens by area, by person. We're able to sort Kaizens if they're a process or a safety or a product Kaizen. And we can do all these reports to them. So this is the entry. On the entry, you have a problem, a solution, who's it submitted by, completion date. Any notes, and the category what it is. Some of the nice features is that if it's a really nice Kaizen that you like to highlight, it has a star by that, so that when you're sorting through all these Kaizens, you can find the ones that you want to share with other people. And then the last one it says new is that you can store pictures. So pictures of Kaizens, or if it's a document, you can show it to them. Okay, this is just this report screen. As I mentioned, we can do all kinds of reports. This is the search screen. You fill that out and are able to get down to whatever you're looking for, down to a shipping operator, graveyard, and what are his Kaizens. This is an example of a safety Kaizen. So it's a very simple thing somebody turned in, is that this is a little golf cart type vehicle, and it's driven around day and night, and they said, well, wouldn't it be a good idea to put a warning reflective on the back? Well, you think, well, that's an obvious thing. Well, if it's so obvious, why hadn't it been done before? So that was a great example of a Kaizen. Okay, this is a little one that I use. This is a great Kaizen card. It's just the size of a business card, and it says, that's a great card, and it says on it, make sure you record it when it's completed. Our biggest problem with Kaizens is people refuse to record them. Too much of a bother, and we're starting to get people to understand. Why is it important to record Kaizens? You got a measurement, obviously, but what else? Go ahead. Other people can use them, and in the same spirit, their example. We have found that where an executive is filling out Kaizens, his direct reports do Kaizens. We found out when department heads fill out Kaizens, their supervisors fill out Kaizens. So the most powerful thing you can do is to be an example. So this is just a card to both complete it, to recognize it, that's a great Kaizen, and then to remind them to record it. Okay, this is a fun activity that I highly recommend. We'll just do two or three of them. This is on the handout. And then we'll just vote by, after I read it, you tell me if yes or no, okay? The corners on red stands are sharp. Have maintenance smooth the edges. Is that a Kaizen, yes or no? Just, is a maintenance request a Kaizen? This actually is a little bit tricky, and we debate this all the time. Jason, what would you say? Is this a Kaizen or is this not a Kaizen? Okay, let's go to the next one. Mike can't access MP2. Added Mike to an MP2. Is that a Kaizen? Yes or no? No, it's not. It's a requisition. Number three, welders and chairs are being left on when not in use. The welders are left on. Make a sign. So is that a Kaizen? Yes, absolutely. You did something. Okay, the next one. Ring around the doorknob in the E10 materials office is exposed. Have facilities come and fix it before an injury occurs. Again, this is tricky for us, because a requisition by itself is not a Kaizen. Now, how do you determine if it's a Kaizen? Go ahead. Yeah, but how do you really determine? We leave it up to the supervisor of the area. So the person that he feels if it's a Kaizen. Now, Dave Winter teaches that in the beginning, if this is their first Kaizen, Are you going to recognize it? Absolutely, if it's their first one, because you want to encourage them. But if they've handed in 10 Kaizens, and this is kind of a lame one, you might use that as an opportunity to provide coaching. That's almost there. That's a great direction, but let's see if we can improve it. So one of the things that Kaizens really can become is a coaching opportunity. So the next one says correct a typo. That is not a Kaizen. So it gives you an idea that really identifying what a Kaizen has been one of our biggest challenges to overcome. Kaizen audits. Review submitted Kaizens. Review the measurement. Audit Kaizen standard work. Go to Gemba to see Kaizens. Audit training presentations. Again, the two missing tools we've found in our system is training and audits. Okay? This is a Kaizen system map, and you notice that it has up here, this is objectives, and then it has principles. We found that it's easier to identify principles not at the first, but as you're doing it. So what are the principles that apply to this? So let's talk about the Kaizen principles for just a minute, okay? Kaizen focuses on improving the process rather than achieving certain results. The purpose of standard work is to provide a baseline to Kaizen against. You can start seeing how the lean tools support each other, Kaizens and standard work. Each person is the project manager for their own Kaizens. Most Kaizens need to be centered around the employee's own work area. It's fun to overcome challenges. Kaizens provide a framework for employee involvement. The basis of Kaizens is creative. So what principles do is frame how and why you're doing something. We so often tell people to do something and don't take the time to tell them why or how to do it. Okay, these are the resources, Shingo Institute. Here at Utah State, Utah MEP. How many of you, by show of hands, how many are familiar with the Utah MEP? Not enough. Okay, let me tell you about the Utah MEP. The Utah MEP is a state agency. It stands for Utah, I can't remember the word, exchange program. Anybody can help? Not even close. let me tell how they are funded. Let me tell you what they do, but I want to make sure you know how they are funded. They're funded three ways. They're funded from the federal government, from the state government, and from the client company. So that means for training, which is what they really provide, they will come into your factory, they will give you training, you pay a third of the cost. And sometimes they have grants that you can apply for and you pay for none of the cost. But generally you pay for a third. They have trained people. They come in and talk about safety, quality, lean. They have courses that they take to your competitors that helps them implement those programs. So Utah has one of the best MEP programs in the nation. If you are not using them, you are not taking advantage of a great resource here in the state of Utah. Third, there's three books that I highly recommend. This first book is by Stephen M. R. Covey. Not Stephen R. Covey. This is M. R., meaning this is Stephen Covey's son. And he has a great book on the speed of trust. And those are some of the principles we're trying to apply, is the concept that nothing is as fast as the speed of trust, or the opposite of that, nothing is as slow as mistrust. Gemba Kaizen talks about setting up Kaizen as a lean tool. It's an excellent book. And the last one is The Essential Deming. Talks about Deming's beliefs of leadership and how to change your company into a learning system as compared to a controlling system. Okay? We're going to do this just a little bit different. We have plenty of time for questions, but if you have a question, we'd invite you to stay. Or if you'd like them to listen to anybody else's questions, if you'd like to go to lunch, it's at 1:30. You're welcome to go. Do you want to tell them where to go real quick? And then we'd love to have you stay. If you'd like to ask me any questions, we'd love to have you stay. But one of the principles we're starting to believe is that improvement is voluntary. So if you'd like to stay, we'd love to have you stay. If you need to make a phone call, if you want to go lunch, whatever, that's fine too. But we'll take questions for about 10 minutes. Okay, go ahead.
This is just a little gift for you. But
thank you.
Yeah, lunch will be, if you go right out into the hallway over to your right, go exit right through those doors, the TSE is down a pathway. You'll see some signs that kind of lead you in that direction. And there are some students that will help you along your way. The students are really friendly. Just ask them for the TSC. They'll show you. It's on the second floor of the TSC on the west side, the ballroom. Lunch is, again, ready at 11:30. So go. There will be some presentations during lunch. Get comfortable. Get something to eat. And we'll be back here. The next keynote is at 12:15.
Okay.
Also, there is a survey. If you could follow or fill that out on the app, we'd really appreciate it. That just kind of lets us know what your expectations are. And, of course, you're going to get all stars.
Okay.
We all loved you.
Thank you. Before you go, this is probably the best tip I can give you. This is the Shingo model. There's many versions of this. This is the version I like the best. On the handout, it says how to get there to it. But if you Google Shingo model handbook at lean.nh, which stands for New Hampshire, this will go over a really good outline of Shingo principles. If you haven't read this, I highly recommend literally tracking this down and starting that Shingo model handbook. So this is our 1 minute break. You're welcome to leave. You're welcome to stay. Whatever choice you make is the right choice. We'll get this. That's not 1 minute. We got to let them clear out. So we're only asking you to clear out or stay, one or the other. And make sure you take a handout if you're interested. There's the pile handouts in the back. Is there a microphone here?
There is one right here.
Okay, would you use it, please? Okay, go ahead. First question.
All right. So my question is when you're hiring new people from, you know, outside of the company, do you teach them about these principles and what's important to keep that true north consistent, or do you expect them to have kind of some understanding before they come in?
We begin to teach them. We have an orientation, but it's just an overview, just a start. Good question, and we do some. Okay, can you take it to the gentleman back there? Do you want to run back there real quick so we can hear? Go ahead.
I have a question. How do you respond to your employees' comments, especially if it's something that's small, like a requisition, like they wanted to have the doorknob fixed? The doorknob is fixed, so they would see it. Do you respond to them beyond that point, or how do you follow up with them?
The most important thing we can do with Kaizans is they are a coaching opportunity. So you take that employee, you say, that's a great idea, that's a great direction. Let's see how we can improve on it. It's not quite a Kaizen. You'd work together with them to make it into a Kaizen, to take it to the next step. Okay, next. Where's the mic? You got it. Thank you.
I actually have it already. So the question I have for you is, you talked about incentives such as voting for the best Kaizen, taking it before a committee. If a Kaizen results in multi-million dollar savings or production for the company, does the person who came up with the idea get to, I know there's company profit sharing, but is there any other incentives for the Kaizen that's going to turn the company around?
That happens to be the number one question. You win. We have debated this a lot and have decided to not emphasize expensive rewards or recognition. If you want to study a book about that, there's a great book called Punished by Rewards. And Punished by Rewards says that we generally reward people wrong, and that we create more harm by rewards than we create. The biggest problem with rewards and the biggest problem with Kaizens is that it's often a team effort. It's often, and then one guy gets this big award and you got 15 people that resent it. We find the biggest reward for Kaizens is allowing people to be creative at work. People love being creative at work and giving them the time. If you wanted to do that, I'd highly recommend that you do not give money. You do not. We looked at this program where we were going to give them 1% of the savings or 10% of the savings, and became huge problem of identifying how much saving you have. And it's almost impossible on most of the Kaizens to identify a savings. That was one of the principles says that we're improving process, not specific results. You generally cannot measure the impact that Kaizens have until they build up over the years. So if you were going to do that, my recommendation would be time off, not money. So most people do not have enough leave, and the leave they allow to go to their families. So those are just some ideas, but highly discourage elaborate recognition systems. Go ahead.
Can you go into more depth about how you do the auditing side of your process, and you know the process of being followed through the audits?
Jared, my man, would you give him a microphone? I want to hear. He does this better than I do.
So what we do is every week we'll pull up the Kaizens that were submitted. Jason's group does about 200 a week. My group's doing about 140. And so I'll pull up department's Kaizens, and I'll start going through that little list, and we do that little exercise. Is this Kaizen, is it not? And what you find out is the same thing Brent said earlier. If they know I'm doing it, then my department heads are doing the same practice, and the supervisors are doing the same. Because they know you don't want to be called up. And if I find preventative maintenance Kaizens that were submitted and approved, then what we'll do is we'll go down to the manager and the supervisor and do coaching on why they approved them. And sometimes it is, this is their first one, all right, we'll let that go. But next time, make sure you coach and talk to them guys about why it's not or why it isn't. At first, we're scared of rejecting, but once you sit down with a team member and explain why it's not a Kaizen, but it's still something that we want to fix, like a electrical cord, you know, coming loose from the machine, they accept it. And once they understand the rules, it doesn't deter them from submitting them. So,
great, Jared. Yeah, that reminds me of the biggest problem with Kaizens, and we still have this problem, and that is somebody turns in a Kaizen and it goes into a black hole. And it's not implemented, it's not rejected. It is better to reject a Kaizen than let it sit there and do nothing. So the worst thing you can do in a Kaizen program is nothing. Okay? Looks like we've got two more questions. Go ahead.
Is the time for Kaizens planned into the day and the budget? Because doing 145 and 200, that's a lot of time for personnel.
Would you hand it to the big guy, Jason? Hand it to Jason. He's over maintenance, by the way.
Which is a lot of fun when it comes to Kaizens. But no, to answer that question, yes, you do have to allot for some time. As Brent said earlier in the presentation, a lot of our Kaizens are small and incremental. So a lot of them do require maintenance. We do schedule that in, especially if it's in a safety category. That would obviously move up the list pretty high. But it can be very overwhelming the black hole of a Kaizen was a very negative thing. Employees would come up to me all the time, hey, when are you gonna do my Kaizen? Gall, we don't really have time. We're in the middle of this huge project. That saw a lot of negative results. So you have to make time to produce results, and then they feel very empowered, and it flows from there. But one more thing on the repair Kaizens, because I see a lot of those. Great opportunity to say, I know the doorknob is broken, and yeah, we'll fix it, and it's not really a Kaizen, but how did it get broken? Is the doorstop not right? Is the wind blowing it open and knocking it off? Things like that can produce Kaizen. So they're thinking in the right direction. Sometimes they just need a little bit of help.
If you want to, go ahead, Jared, then I'll add to that. We've done a lot of work with visual workplace, visual devices, borders, floors, everything. If you haven't studied that, that's a great lean tool. Give them overtime. Get three guys. If you want to teach your employees that improvement is important, have them come in late at night or on a Saturday and give them 3 hours to work on a Kaizen. Let's invest in Kaizens. Okay, one last question. Go ahead.
So with the black hole that you're talking about, this in the company I work for, we OC Tanner, like, we're always trying to find ways to improve, and we get a lot of improvement ideas and Kaizens, but a lot of them don't get implemented just because of the resources or whatever. Like, how do you manage that and avoid those situations? You talked about rejecting them. Like, well, do you go back to them later, or that makes sense?
They would rather get an answer than be ignored. So you're off to do it, and tell them the truth. They know the truth anyway. Whether the truth is, just tell them the truth. If you're not going to implement it because of resources, tell them that. There's generally a reason why it's not going to be implemented. So I use the word rejected on purpose, but if a kinder, softer one is that we're not implementing at this time because of this reason. So you don't have to use the word reject, but it's what it is. So we're not going to implement it this time for this reason. Just talk to them. Tell them whatever the reason is. Tell them the truth. It's better than ignoring them.
How do you go back to it? Like, so at this time we're not going to do it. Do you guys have ways to look back at the Kaizens that maybe weren't implemented 6 months ago, or do they have to resubmit it?
A little both. There's no magic answers. Just okay. Work at it. I'm sure you are, but we had a lot of fear about rejecting Kaizens, and we found that they almost universally accept. We appreciate your help, and either turn it into a real Kaizen, turn it into something else, or just thank them. Thanks for your help. Okay, you're welcome to go. If anybody would like to stay and talk to me individually, you're welcome to do that, but we have to get you to lunch on time. Make sure you take a handout. I think it's worth your while.
perfect. I'm going to go get...